See, people just think that somehow God is going to move outside of them. He's not. He's going to move through you. And then everybody's sitting around, I don't know, waiting on everybody else or something. When in reality, a great move of God comes because all of God's people participate, not one or two. And there's got to be somebody, some group of people somewhere that lead the charge. Somebody's got to take the charge. Somebody's got to take the charge. Somebody, when they see everybody retreating or languishing or sitting off to the sides, got to grab the rallying flag and charge the hill. Now, there aren't a lot of those kind of people in the world, but I believe there are those kind of people here. And you have to understand, people, you have to understand, Father has sovereignly done the things that we talk about when we refer to the baptism of the Holy Ghost in fire. He's sovereignly done that. And Father sovereignly moves. You listen to me very carefully, because I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to define church for you tonight. I'm going to define church for you. I'm going to define God's purpose and will for your life, maybe in a way that you've never heard or never been willing to hear or basically have been too immature to hear in the realms of the Spirit. Because I'm going to tell you right now, one of the beautiful things about spiritual growth and maturity is you get to understand more about the will of the Father. People think that they, based on their intellect and their ability to reason and read and whatnot, that they can figure it out. You can't figure nothing out. You can understand very simple things like Jesus came, born of a virgin, bore our sins in his own body on the tree, so that now all we got to do is call upon his name, we'll be saved, we'll be healed, delivered. And a lot of people never even really heard that, because it's almost like the salvation message was almost imprisoned within the word zotza, for example, the Greek word for salvation, which means salvation, deliverance, healing, complete wholeness. Imagine if everybody went around and said, preach salvation on the level that Christ Jesus died for your sins at Calvary's tree so that you could receive complete wholeness. Hallelujah. So that you could become a new creation, a new man, old things passed away, spirit, soul, and body being impacted by the power of the Holy Ghost so it could be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Suddenly, all of a sudden, people's faith realm goes to a whole nother level when they begin to embrace him as provider, as perfecter, and as protector, rather than just some little dimension of God somewhere in my life and I'm not really sure where it's at, and I'm hanging on with by my little fingernails or whatever, you know. I'm hanging on, barely hanging on to this walk with God. I'm going to tell you right now, that's not a walk with God. Fix my microphone. That's not a walk with God. That's not a walk with God. A walk with God is one that is realm, that is in the realms of the heavenly. And I'm going to talk to you tonight about that. It is a heavenly realm. It's where you get to live and function and move and exist and speak out of a realm called heaven. Let me just tell you something. I'm not interested in all the religious ideologies. You pick and choose whatever flavor you like, whatever flavor strikes your personal preferences. But I'm not interested in any of it. I want the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ on the level that Jesus described it, and then it was ultimately made manifest when they were baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire on that first day, and they were it looked like they were drunk. They were so overwhelmed with heaven's divine power and glory. You know, the Lord spoke to me recently, said, listen, my church is not about singing and preaching. And people want to make it about singing and preaching. He said, my church is about flowing in the Holy Ghost that produces singing and preaching. Hallelujah. And there's just too many people that are willing to just participate with a sing-along song or whatever, you know. Listen, no. If a song brings you into flowing in the Holy Ghost, well, then that's fine. If it's not, you're not in church. You're just doing a religious thing. Ringing the bell. Tonight, I want to talk to you about what it means to be so overwhelmed by the power and the glory of God that you stagger out into the street and 3,000 people get saved. What it means the next day, as it were, you go out and there's somebody sitting at the gate called Beautiful who's been crippled from his mother's womb, and you say, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. It's about time that people understand the gifting of the Holy Ghost so that you and I can understand this wonderful realm of heaven and the dimension of God's divine power and glory, the riches, the true riches. People running around trying to fill a bank account when all the things of the riches of heaven lay unused. Unused. To know who we are and to know what we have. To look at the lame man and say, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Yeah. To have prayer meetings. That was Acts 3. To have prayer meetings in Acts chapter 4. Where being in the situation of being threatened and being chastised, they cry out to God and say, Father, stretch forth your hand and grant signs and wonders by your holy child Jesus. And when they prayed, the place was shaken. Come on, man. If you want to sit by and lullaby yourself to sleep with religious ditties, fine. But I'm not me, man. I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it. If you want to sit around and high-five one another that you know what it is you know, fine. But it ain't anywhere close to what God described He gave to us when He poured out the Holy Ghost and fire and said, these works and greater works than these. He said, by these works you will know that the Father is in me and that I am in him. By these works you'll know that I don't do this by myself, but by the Father does it through me. And the very next thing He says, and these works which I do shall you do in greater works, which is saying, and this display of the Father being in me, and even a display greater than this, will be in anyone who believes. Yes. You and I need to check the way we believe. We're going to have to check our belief systems here. Because we're just willing to have a religious crutch to get us through the day, and much of the world has said what they've said about us is pretty much true. Their observation has been pretty much correct, because we've let all this glory and all this power and all this heavenly beauty just slide away and play second fiddle to our will. We've been willing to speak our own words, think our own thoughts, live our own lives, when God gave us His words to speak, His thoughts to think, and His life to live. Think about it. It's about time you get shaken up by the Spirit of the Lord and recognize there's a price to pay for the glory that's been poured out. It didn't take long, and the Holy Ghost churches were such in power and displayed in power that everybody knew it was the Holy Ghost in charge. And Peter says, why is it that Satan has deceived you and tempted you and caused you to lie to the Holy Ghost? Because the Holy Spirit is here. And they fell down dead. I want the living of God where the authority of heaven is seen with such demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power as it was in Stephen's life, that there was nobody that could discount him. And his wisdom and the spirit that he had was irresistible. A place where he stood, where heaven was open, and he wasn't just having a little imagination, a little imprint on his mind when he closed his eyes, but could see Father sitting there and Jesus standing at his right hand with the heavens open before him. Come on, I'm telling you right now, God the Holy Ghost is pushing you. He's proclaiming these things. He's beckoning you. He's beseeching you. He's saying, when is enough enough of your own life? When will you quit substituting that which you have and calling it mine? When? That's what Papa says. There's a price to pay. I mean, there's a Holy Ghost realm where Philip can go down and preach. Now I'm in Acts 8. I'm just walking through Acts, okay? If you didn't know that, I'm walking through Acts. You'll have to catch up later. Get in your Bible, start reading it, to change your position of life. Philip goes down and preaches Jesus in Samaria, and the whole place is set on fire with the glory of heaven. As they watch, the devils go out with the word which he spoke, and those who were crippled be made whole. Such that he was so under the mandate of the Holy Ghost, he went by the Spirit of the Lord and joined himself unto a eunuch, then led the eunuch into the realms of salvation, and then was caught up by the Holy Ghost and translated to another region of the Middle East, just like in the days of Elijah. Just as Jesus was translated many times, that's how the scripture says, and he passed through their hands. You don't pass through a bunch of mad, angry people who surrounding you and they got a hold of you. Unless you get translated, you disappear. I'm looking for a Holy Ghost realm that has power and demonstration that Jesus described, how that God anointed him with the Holy Ghost and power, who went out doing good, healing everyone who was oppressed of the devil. And then it say, went about doing good, healing some who were oppressed of the devil. I preached this the other night in another place, and one man of God got angry. He said, do you know what he said? He said, it's God's will that everybody be healed. Mm-hmm. What a thing to get angry about. Where is the faith level set in your life? I want you to know Jesus Christ as one who redeemed you with His blood. I want you to know His name is the powerful name that has authority over everything. Paul looks at the woman who had the spirit of Python, which was that demonic. It was literally a serpent that was worshipped in her region. And he said, in the name of Jesus Christ, go. And it immediately went. She's completely set free and delivered. The authority, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they'll cast out devils. There's got to be somebody somewhere in some place who now has enough authority not to have a fasting and prayer meeting for 40 days before there's a flicker of movement. It's time people get real with God. Amen. It's just time we just get real. And that's why I was so excited about Sunday night, because two Sunday nights ago, I'm like going, hey, I'm starting, this is exactly what I'm looking for. People go home because they don't know the realms of the spirit and the powers of darkness will hit them right, left, and center and basically accuse them of emotionalism, accuse them of this and accuse them of that. If you can't accuse them of anything, get them distracted with this thing, that thing, and the other thing, so they're just back to the same thing. Somebody's got to get valiant in their heart. Somebody's got to pick up the flag and run the hill. Somebody's gonna have to get real. Somebody's gonna have to quit lingering, wait for somebody else to move.
Come on.
That sounds like Israel sitting around under the leadership of Saul, not willing to take a risk. And praise God, David showed up. Praise God, there was somebody with total abandonment said, you know what? I tell you right now, I'd rather not even live than have to sit here and listen to this. I'd rather not even live than to have to sit here and accommodate this. I'd rather not even live than to believe that everything that I've been taught about the people of God, the people of Israel, and who God is, amounts to this. Come on.
Yes.
So I don't need your armor. I don't need all the stuff you trust in. I've got the name of God. I know Him. I know Him. I felt Him when He moved upon me with His Holy Spirit. Ha! I felt His power and His glory come upon me when I began to prophesy, when my heart was carried away in a place that no emotion that I had ever experienced could take me to before. I know the glory when it comes upon you and the zeal of the Lord touches you and the bear is nothing before you and the lion as well. There's many people who have never even begun to deal with the sin that oppresses them. They've never really begun to deal with the hindering spirits that stand in their face and breathe their hellacious breath in their face every day and do nothing about it. Their threats, their lies, their accusation, their guilt, their threats where they, you know, basically say, you can be only this and nothing less, nothing more, rather. It's about time somebody believes in the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
That so transforms us, that so changes us, that so cleanses us, that we become those vessels fit for the Holy Ghost to come dwell on the inside of. And then now the Holy Ghost come taking up habitation, and we still interested in the houses and cars and clothes and this and vacation and that thing, and we promoting who we are and our jobs and what we can. Forget about it. You'll never know this glory. You'll only have religion there. You'll never know this realm. You'll never know it. It'll be aloof, and then you're going to start making new doctrines about it. And I'm going to tell you right now, the surgeon's knife will become more effective than the moving of the Holy Ghost. The things of this world more meaningful and more valuable to you than those true riches that are unseen. Now, come on, people. I want you to stir yourself up. I'm not going to be able to be here tomorrow night because I've already made a commitment to Pat and Karen Schatzlein. But I'll encourage all of you to be here for prayer meeting. Just get here and pray. Get here. Get here and get your seat. Get here. Listen, God's looking for some people. Allow Him to move through them. We thank the Holy Spirit, who is a person, for being willing to come and live on the inside of us. But how you reckon it feels when He's brought all majesty and glory and honor and power and authority and the ability to do everything the Father's ever purposed man to do, and we just basically maybe give Him 10 minutes a day praying in the Holy Ghost. We maybe give them just a little bit of time. And there's a lot of people, I mean, this is a cut above. There's a lot of people living in the land of limbo that should have never happened. They live in Jesus' earthly ministry and never stepped into Jesus' heavenly ministry. And he said, you can't even be witnesses of me. You can't even testify of me. In church, out of church, nowhere. You can't even begin to know anything about representing heaven until you're baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. And that is expressed within the realms of divine utterances that begin to change and activate everything about our life, begin to change and activate ways of speaking that are different than we've ever spoken before. The results is being able to understand verses of Scripture like Joel did, like Joel spoke. Peter understood Joel in a new context as a result of this wonderful divine utterance that had suddenly hit him, and he begins to say, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. We just want to go and sit around and write out little sermons that we think everybody's going to be impressed with. God, give us a break. By intervening in this situation and busting it to pieces. That's the way I feel about it.
Yeah.
And wiping the slate clean. I'm going to tell you right now, if there's nothing else that I can be, I'll be a rallying point. I'll be a point of something that people are going to accept or are they going to radically reject. You're not going to stand too long around me straddling the fence. Something's going to give. Hallelujah. Something will give. Why? Because I purpose to have what God described. When Jesus said, the Holy Ghost is with you and he shall be in you. In that day you should know that the Father is in me and that I'm in you and you are in me. I'm here to have that which Jesus described when he said the Holy Ghost is going to take everything that belongs to the Father and he's going to reveal it to you, transmit it to you, make it known to you. He's going to show you things to come. We walk around basically blind. We can't see what's coming. We're blind because our eyes are filled with the sight of the world. And we wonder, why is it that visions and dreams and word of knowledge and word of discernment and word of wisdom, which is something that should flow so naturally through our lives, is so aloof? Because we occupied with something other than God. Maybe we don't want to deal with that. They want to say, we don't want to reach way back into their history and say, I had a move of God one time. See, this is proof that I'm right. I want to reach back in the far, far, far weeks and months in the past and say, I have one event. What is that? What's that proof of? All that was is the declaration that God would surely like to use you every day. He'd surely like to come around and be living you as a habitation, not just visit every once in a while. Oh my God, we had a prayer meeting. It was amazing. 6 months ago. Whoa. It was like I was praying in the Holy Ghost for like a whole 15 minutes. That shouldn't define revival. That should define an off day. That should define an off day. Unfortunately, today it defines revival. Defines a move of God. Hallelujah. A week ago Sunday night, I left because Ann and I were just so tired. My eyes were crossed. It was a miracle I could stand here and preach. I was numb. My hands were numb. My arms were numb. I was so tired. I was just numb. And I told Anna on the way home, I said, baby, this is it. I mean, this is the threshold. This is where you stand at the door. This is the door of the move of God. This is the doorway. This is where you, what was going on here and those waves of glory that was sweeping over people here. That's just the doorway. You ain't even in yet. It's just the doorway. Just imagine where you're at when you're not there. Way out yonder. Roaming about. As one friend of mine said, lurking around. There's too many lurking. That's a Phil Smithers word. There's too many lurking. Come on, man. Come on, people. Come on, people. Talk to you about a treasure. Open your Bibles to Acts chapter 2, verse 30. I'm going to talk to you about a treasure. I'm talking to you about something that you don't have to beg God for. Father's petitioning you. This is the ministry of Jesus. People always want to try to find a defense for do they have to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire? And just to ask the question that way shows the wrong heart. They ask the question, do you have to have divine utterances as proof of being baptized in the Holy Ghost? That right there shows a disposition of a wrong heart. Why would you want anything else? Then they go looking for, scratching around to try to find one verse of Scripture that can be understood in many different ways. One verse of Scripture which you can never define any doctrine off anyways. You got to have two or three, and it's got to be in context for heaven's sake. Amen. And said, a rhetorical question. Do all speak with tongues? See, I told you. You don't even know those people were baptized. They aren't baptized in the Holy Ghost yet. Obviously. If you just leave, there's so many different ways to translate that. But if somebody asked me this, does all speak with tongues? I'd go, no, they've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost yet. And that would be the biblical answer. But we go off in these crazy imaginations and think that God smiles at it. He grieves him. He's given us the glory and the riches of heaven. He purified us with his own blood so that you and I could be vessels to carry around heaven so that men might see that there's a better realm to live in than in darkness. There's a better realm to live in than in hell. There's a better realm to live in than to be overrun by demon spirits, by sickness and disease and sorrow and torment and depression. Man, I guarantee you, if depression ever hit me, I'd fight it to the ground, the very, I'd walk around, if that's all I had, I'd hold my face up, I'd say, oh God, whatever it takes, I don't want to misrepresent you. If it took putting a mask over my face and painting a clown smile on it and putting a recorder in my pocket that was a continual joyful sound, whatever it took. And I tell you right now, when people are that serious about what God wants, people are serious about what they want, they'll self-justify till there is no tomorrow about why they feel the way they feel, or why they act the way they act, or why they live the way they live, all the time defying the Word of God and standing against the will of the Father. I'm talking the manifest will, not the touchy-feely will, which people imagine with their hearts and minds. I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not spending quality time in the Word of God every day, I'm going to tell you right now, the thief is stealing from you. Because you're either going to get built up in the faith and get built up in the Word, and you're going to understand how to function over in this realm, which is called the mind of Christ, the mind of God, the mind of the Spirit. People think they can have the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit, the mind of God, just by thinking whatever thoughts they want to have occupying their life and occupying their thoughts all day long. And every once in a while, oh, Lord Jesus, thank you so much. And then that's about it. The mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit, is something that is given to us. It's ours. It belongs to us. It's supposed to be at least a wellspring springing up. I mean, I'm telling you, an artesian never quits flowing. I'm telling you, there's about a supponiniandia that should never quit flowing. Amen. I mean, this is a place of praying without ceasing and rejoicing forevermore. But I'm telling you, I watch as people rather build themselves up in the wrong way. They give lots of place to having things that are not what God wants being cultivated and developed and mature in their life. They give lots of time to depression. They give lots of time to all kinds of vain imaginations. Give lots of time to thinking bad about others. People that are around me, they know, man, you start talking bad about Holy Ghost leadership, you start talking bad about God's people, I'll become one very upset person. I try to calm down and try to help people understand things in the right perspective. But see, I'm given over to another realm. I'm given over to a Holy Ghost realm. I hate the demonic realm. That's why I have authority against demon spirits to cast them out. That's why I have authority against sickness and disease. My heart belongs to heaven. Amen. My spirit belongs. My mouth belongs to heaven. There's nothing more demonic than running down another human being. There's nothing more demonic than speaking out curses against someone you're supposed to be interceding for. Come on, people, you better listen to me. You better understand the right way. There's nothing more beautiful. See, our culture and the world that we live in has no real value for lowliness. They have no real value for humility and meekness. They have no real value for submission. They have no real value for purity and love and joy. They have value for how well you do mathematics. They have value for how well you do chemistry. They have value for how well you make money. They have value for how well you can do all these other things that serve their human interests, man's interest, earthly interest. But such a thing should not be among God's people. Listen, dear people, we got to grab a hold of the gift that has been given us. God gave us the richest, listen to me, God gave us the richest gift that exists. And we act like it's a bunch of tin and copper. You hear me? We more interested in the dollar bill. We more interested in the things that belong to what men praise and value. And I'm telling you, you can't serve both of them. You're either going to serve God or you're going to serve mammon. You can't serve both of them. You understand me?
Yes.
Father don't need all of our. I'm going to tell you right now, when God gives you an anointing to make wealth, it doesn't take you away from flowing in the anointing, flowing in the Holy Ghost. It does not. In fact, it gets you that much more in that realm, that much more dependent, that much more focused, that much more passionate, that much more on your knees, that much more in the Word of God, that much more seeking Him and desiring the things which He has. Because I'm going to tell you right now, until you become needy, you can't ever be hungry and thirsty. And what's happening is people are so filling themselves up with false securities. They're so filling themselves up with other identities that they have no need. They have no need. They're fine. They're fine. They're clothed and they're rich and they have need of nothing. That's where Jesus says, you are wretched, you miserable, you poor, and you blind. Because they've allowed everything that should be rather directed towards heaven to be filled up with false things, earthly things, demonic distractions. Come on, people. Listen to me. I want you to give a heavenly vision tonight. I want you to get a heavenly vision that drives you to your knees. I want you to get a heavenly vision that drives you to a place of need. Because I'm going to tell you, out of that need comes hunger and thirsting. And it's that hunger and thirsting that Father is going to baptize with His glory and give to an unlimited supply of His presence. That's what He says, both Old Testament and New Testament. Man, if you're high on yourself and high on your accomplishments and high on the things that men have valued you with, you'll never come into understanding what I'm talking about here tonight. You're going to have to go into a place where you no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives. And all that is meaning for you and all that is valuable to you is the will of the Father, because He wants to display a glory in your life that is a proof that it's Him moving, activating, living, speaking, thinking, and acting through you. So how is God ever going to do that when all that's really going on is it's you living out your own life, doing your own things, pursuing your own interests, going after your own desire? Then it's not. It's just simply not. And that is very practical to understand. There are no hard dots to connect here. It's just tonight, we're just going to have to decide whose life we want to live, because the Lord's called us to a realm of glory. He says, I want to reproduce myself in you. Father is cultivating a fruit. Listen to me. Father is cultivating a fruit, and He wants to reproduce Himself in us. He's cultivating a fruit that says, you've got to deny yourself if this is ever going to be produced, because that's what He says. He said in John chapter 12, verse 24, unless a grain of seed fall into the ground and die, it abides alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. And He tells us very clearly at the very next verse, He tells us we're going to have to lose our life if we're going to find it. He tells us very clearly. He gives us very clear direction. And I mean, my goodness gracious, it shouldn't be that difficult when we're overwhelmed, overshadowed, when the power of the Holy Ghost comes upon us and shows us such an exciting and glorious realm in which we now may live out our lives, full of joy unspeakable and full of glory, peace that passes understanding, a realm that defies all description, a realm that will settle everything. I'm going to tell you, listen to me. You listen to me. Father looks at us and examines us. He watches our every day. And I'm telling you, it's not about works. But if our passion for our lives is where our hours are spent, doing our own thing, and everybody can self-justify. Huh? The scale is tipped. We're going to have to understand that those passionate hours that we're using to do all these things that we're supposedly doing for a divine interest, huh, is going to have to become something that is less than the passion described and the affection described and revealed in our pursuit of allowing that which God has given us to be manifested through our life. I want to see it right now. I want to see the glory of God. Yeah. I want to see the power of God. Show me. Yeah. And if you cannot show me right now, instantaneously, you need to get yourself in a place with God where there's a free course of the flow of the Holy Spirit allowed to move through your life. There should always be an artesian, at least a wellspring springing up with the glory of God. And then he says, I want to take it to another level. You know, there's many people who just want to say that the wellspring that Jesus was talking about with respect to the gift of God to the woman at the well, that he was only describing salvation experience. Well, fine. I'm not going to argue with that. Fine. But I'm going to tell you one thing for certain. In John chapter 7 and verse 38 and 39, he was talking about a day that was going to come, a baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire that would be an expression of God flowing through our lives. And it would be on the scale so unlimited, so beyond that which could be contained. It's like rivers. And you and I are willing to sit around and not have that. That's the problem. You and I are willing to accommodate something less than that. That's the problem. Why? Because the need's not there. I'd rather the hunger and thirst is not there. Why? Because the need's not there. You and I need to deal with it. I'm going to tell you, turning back to God deals with that. Coming and honestly looking at the Word of God that would search us out and examine us. The honest examination of the Spirit of the Lord causes us to realize, man, we need to turn back to God. We need to turn back to His way. The thing that happens when you turn back to God and turn back to His way is a moving of His Spirit called revival. What is revival? It's a place where you come into an inheritance in God. Yeah. It's a place where you begin to move in the inheritance that He's given. What kind of inheritance is He's given? He's made us heirs. He's made us heirs with Himself. And we just shrug our shoulders and act like it's not real. Hello? Yeah.
You're right.
We shrug our shoulders and act like it's something less than what we get at work. We shrug our shoulders and act like it's something less than we get at the hospital. We shrug our shoulders and act like it's something less that we get from the lawyer. We shrug our shoulders and act like it's something less than we get from the grocery store, which is our protection, our provision. Huh? And in many respects, people's what they feel is their perfection. It's all right, these children aren't in church. Much. They're getting ready to become church members. You just have to excuse them. They're on the front row because they're my grandchildren, but they have no church manners. Don't worry, they'll get it. Right now, I'll just out-preach them. Because of Bartimaea. Le manga le sature. She wants to be the entertainer. Bless her little heart. She's very cute. It's her birthday today. It's her birthday. And we're so blessed that she's here. But the most important thing for her, for every person here tonight, for me, for the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, is to open up our ears and hear what God has called us to come into. Amen. Because He hasn't made it difficult. He hasn't made it to where that you and I've got to do some great feat to have it. That's really how disinterested we are in God. Because He's made it so easy. He's sovereignly moved. He's sovereignly given it. It's His divine will. He's made it available for all, easily to have, instantaneously. But that's how disinterested we are. No, we come and we get passionate in the church and we sing their songs and we're like, I'm feeling really woo, good, high, kind of, you know, wow. Jesus. And then we go out and live our own life for the rest of the week. And He gets 1 hour, 2 hours. Father's looking for truth in the inward parts. He's not interested in any fake kisses. He's not interested in any fake smiles. He's interested in a display of the heart that Amen. Begins to appreciate and value the riches which he's given. Jesus, who is rich, this is the riches and how to describe it. When we describe riches, we describe it on the basis of how Jesus was rich and who for our sakes became poor, that we through his poverty might inherit his riches. We're talking about a heavenly realm, a place where we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in a heavenly place, a place where the divine power of glory would so arrest our spirit that we're going to instantly go up and we're going to go and begin to minister the word of truth to where people's hearts are transformed and changed and nations are birthed in our spirit. And the power of God is able, have free course through our life to have the same ministry of Jesus Christ. Father didn't call us to another ministry. There's not another ministry. So I said, I'm just trying to understand what my ministry is. Why are you trying to understand what your ministry is? Jesus showed us his ministry. We've been received his life. God doesn't have different lives, different ministries. There's not different gods. There's one God, one ministry, one faith, one Lord Jesus Christ, yeah. one person to follow, one place to go. Yeah. It's just that it doesn't fit into our little package. You listening to me? Doesn't fit into our little framework of where our real security comes from. We know our security comes from the U.S. dollar. We know where our hope comes from, the bank. Yeah. You break that and you'll start moving in a gift of faith. You break that. I know what I'm talking about. You break that stronghold and you'll start moving in a gift of faith. They will begin to call things into play, into reality. They begin to call things that are impossible, unreachable, into a living reality. And the arm of flesh won't do one bit of, the arm of flesh will not be involved. The arm of flesh, everything that God has ever done in my life that has of any value had no arm of flesh in it. I did not spend 1 hour earning one penny to make it happen. It's all in a realm of faith. It's all in a realm of moving in the authority of the one who owns cattle on 1,000 hills. It all belongs to him, the heaven and earth. He rolled back the heavens like a curtain. He yeah. makes the mountains move. He'll remove every hindrance before you like he poured, rolled back the seas. Like he rolled back the Jordan. Those who are passionate about doing what he's called to do. I mean, I called us to do. It's like I've said before. You get so serious about going to the nations and you don't have any way to get there, that you just decide, God's called me to China. I have no ticket to go. I'm going to get myself a rowboat and start rowing. I'm launching out from San Diego, Point Loma tomorrow. I'm headed for China. I guarantee you, you move like that, and you're going to get the best ride that is possible. I would imagine translation at that level. I'd imagine at that level, you're going to get translated right there. Poof, you're going. You there in seconds. It's time that God's people begin to move. See, what we've done is from the pulpit, we have diluted the power and the authority of God and talked about how God works in hand with the doctors. Why? Because none of us have been willing to mature to a greater faith. We prayed for people and we're not willing to recognize we just haven't matured to that realm and that level yet. Somebody gets one little gifting here, one little gifting there, but it only works here or only works there, and it doesn't work everywhere else. I knew people who had the power of God move on them to raise the dead, and they can't cast out a devil. I know people that had the power to raise the dead, and they can't heal a migraine headache. I can go on. People, you know, back and forth. When Father, and praise God for what's happening. I'm just saying, there's a great big void. There's a great big room, an opportunity where nobody seems to be willing to step into. It's time, people, that you and I get serious. You don't have much time to live. By the mercy and the grace of God, you're going to die and be in heaven. Huh? And what you've done, that's it. I mean, it would be pathetic for me to die right now. I do not want to die right now and go to heaven. I have done so little. I would hate to have to spend eternity on what I've done in the kingdom of God. Give me a break. No, sir. I'm telling you right now, I'm not going to run the risk of breathing out my last breath and saying I could have done a whole lot more. And I recognize that I cannot do anything without Him. I recognize I've got to take a hold of a realm and divine power and glory that has been given and then move. I've watched as many people, listen to me, I've watched as many people have been touched by the power of the living God. I've watched them as they've been moved by the Spirit of the Lord. But then they didn't do anything with it. They went back to their same old stuff. They put all of their stuff that they do on an everyday basis bigger to them and more important to them because they get the praises of men out of it. You listen to me?
Yes.
Probably everybody, just about everybody in this place has had some encounter with God. Maybe even everybody in this place or most everybody in this place have been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. But you weren't willing to go all the way. And thus, because you're not willing to go all the way with God, you know, your growth is stunted in maturing in the gifts of faith, the increase with the increase of God, the development of the things of the Spirit, to where that the fullness of the maturity, the ministry of Jesus begins to be manifested. Look, in Paul's life, it didn't take more than 17 years. It probably took less than that. When he suddenly realized what the new covenant was all about, when he suddenly realized that Father had purposed to reveal His Son in him, That it wasn't just the revelation of Jesus, the Son, the only begotten Son on the road to Damascus, but this gift of divine grace and this miracle that God had worked through salvation would result in him having received a complete regeneration to where that the Word of God had produced within him and the Spirit of God had produced within him the very reproduction of Christ Jesus, the Son. Immediately, he did not confer with flesh and blood, but went 3 years into the desert, and there God had fully divulged what the new covenant looks like. And he comes and he writes 2/3 of the New Testament telling us what it looks like and then describing to us by example, here's what I did. The grace of God was not bestowed upon me in vain, but I labored more than them all. And look at the testimony in Romans 15:19, with signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost. I fully preached the gospel. What better thing is there to live your life for? Are you going to live your life to do some menial task for men when all the time you've been made an heir of God and a co-heir to a Jesus? It's about time we place the riches, the true riches, where they really belong. It's about time we begin to value this gift of God that has been given to us. I mean, look here with me real quickly, and let me just point this out to you on the simplicity of it all and how easy God has made it. I mean, you know, Jesus is telling them. I mean, it's the mandate of the sovereign will of the sovereign living God. Go, wait. You must be endued with power from on high. He says, John knows him not after the Spirit, but after the flesh, because he was Jesus' cousin. But the Lord said, the day you see heaven open and the power of the Holy Ghost come upon somebody and remain, that's the one. And that he was the one who came and witnessed. This is the one that will baptize in the Holy Ghost and fire. The last thing that Jesus said is, remember, John baptized with water, but you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. And he goes on to say and describe, this is the promise of the Father. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And then shall you be my witnesses. Then shall you be empowered to give a testimony of who I am and the salvation which I have wrought. This is what God says. I want you to get stirred up. Listen, Pat, I love Pat. He's like my brother. I mean, it's like we've known each other all of our lives, and we've only known each other for a year, a little over a year. And there's a mantle of revival and stirring people up to begin to step in. And really, I call it a mantle of turning. Everybody else calls it a mantle of revival. I call it a mantle of turning the church back to God. But see, the church can't even believe that it's there. It can't even believe that it needs to turn back to God. Church standing around like they've been doing everything right, and God's coming up short. Somehow we're going to have to get his attention so he can do what it is he promised. That's the way our psyche thinks when we're not being bathed in the glory of the Holy Ghost, in which the mind of the Spirit and the mind of the Word and the mind of Christ and the mind of God takes full control of our perceptions and our thinking and our imaginations and our thoughts. The knowledge of Christ Jesus. Look how easy the Lord made it. It's his sovereign will. Peter now describing it in verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you. Listen, I'm going to say this before I get here. There are people mealy-mouthed and around acting like they got nothing to talk about but the weather and their new clothes. And that's supposed to be an icebreaker so they can talk to somebody about Jesus. That ain't no icebreaker. All that is just a spiraling down into deeper realms of carnal humanity. Listen to me. When Peter, before he was baptized in the Holy Ghost, he was afraid too. I'm going to tell you, everything that is evil and everything that is wicked and everything that holds people back within the realms of that which God would express to their lives is nothing but the spirit of fear. And God delivered us from the spirit of fear, which is bondage, and gave us the spirit of His Son, whereby we say, God Almighty is my dad. Amen. My daddy. Hallelujah. Amen. Got three people clapping and the rest of the people are doing something else. Come on, man. You need to stir yourself up. You need to stir yourself up. You need to find some way to stir yourself up. Whatever it takes, you need to stir yourself up. It's time somebody and sit around and just basically pat you on the back saying you're doing okay. I'm going to tell you, if you're not flowing the Holy Ghost, you're not doing well at all. You're at the point of death. You're walking all over what the blood purchased for you. You're living without the glory that has been given you, that cost such a heaven such a high price. You're living without, you're defying the will of the Father. Father wants to display His glory. He's willing to display His glory through our lives. Through mighty signs and wonders. Paul just took a hold of the ministry of Jesus. We understand how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, the Holy Ghost and power, went about doing good, healing all oppressed with the devil, for God was with him. All Paul did was follow Jesus' ministry. All he did was take a hold of that gift which God had given, and he didn't count it as some small thing. Did Paul do all of these things? Well, you all got to work. Paul worked. He's going to stand right there on the day of judgment, right beside you guys who use the excuse that you got to go to work. And he say, I worked. I made tents. I was beholding to no man. And he did what he did from Jerusalem to Illyricum. Get yourself in gear. Get rid of all your excuses. They're nothing but lies. They're nothing but demonic doctrine. They false doctrine. If you got up and preached your excuses, everybody would shout you down and say, lies. You've been listening to the wrong spirit. You've been reading the wrong Bible. You've been believing the wrong things. People think it's so special because they know how to spout out orthodox doctrines while all the time they live unorthodox lives. I'm not interested as much in orthodox doctrines as I am in orthodox lives. I've seen people live orthodox lives, the lives that the Word of God describes, and their doctrine was far from orthodox. Pentecostal Jesus only, baptized in the name of Jesus only, with the proof of salvation being speaking in divine languages. Their doctrine is wrong. Their doctrine is off. But many live very orthodox lives. They live the lives of Jesus Christ because they've taken a hold of the ministry of the Holy Ghost, and they've held up the ministry of Holy Ghost as bigger than anything else, because Jesus went away and sent the Holy Ghost, and everything that Jesus is doing and everything the Father is doing is through the Holy Ghost. And it's time we stop giving Him a pink slip. Sorry, He's absent. He can't be here tonight. Sorry, the Holy Spirit can't be here tonight. Because there's people here that would be offended. Sorry, the Holy Ghost can't be here tonight. He is going to be a few of us after the meeting if anybody would like to come and join. But let me just let you know right now, He's shocking. It's kind of embarrassing. My God. My God. We blaspheme in the Holy Spirit. We're speaking all kinds of evil things against Him. Father says, don't you mess with the Holy Ghost. You mess with me, but don't you mess with the Holy Ghost. Can you hear that? Guys, can you hear that? Can you hear that? You mess with me, but don't you mess with my wife. I'm telling you right now, I'm going to lose everything of sanctification you think I got. I'm telling you right now. I'm telling you, judgment's coming down. It will be the judgment day for you. That's what the Lord says. That's what Father says. That's what Jesus said. And I'm with Him, man. I'm telling you, I'm saying with Father, don't mess with the Holy Ghost. Don't mess with Him. Don't mess with Him. Father, the Holy Spirit is so merciful and He's so gracious. I was telling the Holy Spirit the other night, I was saying,
Holy Spirit, I thank you so much for your mercy towards me, for your forgiveness towards me, for your love and your mercy towards me. I've been so disrespectful towards you, going long hours without recognizing you, without giving place to you, and even allowing thoughts and things to go into my life that are just totally offensive to you. Forgive me. I'll never be that way again. Thank you for shaking me into reality. He's so merciful. You can sit here and you can be all bad and sad about yourself, but you know nothing. You never, there's no cure for that. Because when you get all upset about yourself, then he's talking bad about us. Oh, man, I'm talking big bad about you. But you're not your cure. And you're just going to get all upset if you think you're your cure. And if your natural response is to look to yourself to have all these things, you didn't have nothing. And I'm going to tell you right now, you might as well brace yourself because you're going to be upset every time you come hear me preach. It's going to be a bad day for you every day you come and listen to me minister. So I'm going to talk to us about the will of the Father. I'm going to talk to us about something that only Holy Ghost can make real in our life. And that's going to demand every bit of surrender in your life to Him. It's going to demand you begin to honor Him. It's going to demand you get real with Him. It's going to demand that you say His truth is His word. His word is His truth. And there's no substitute. And there's no mixing. And there's no shortcut. And as soon as you take 99.99% truth and mix it with 0.001% lie, you got yourself a lie. You got yourself a falsehood. Right. It's about time we just quit diluting God's word. Amen. Quit changing it to suit our circumstance. Constantly redefining what God said. God's definition needs no redefinition. God's definition is Jesus. He is the word. That is the definition. He is the word, the logos, the declaration. He is the word, the revelation. Amen. And Father's called you and I to come and bow our knee. And I'm for one going to bow my knee. And everybody I can talk to that are sitting in the Christian community, I'm going to call you out. Yes. Come on over here into the realms of the heavenly community. Yes. Come on over here into the realms of the Holy Ghost. Over here into the realms of truth, the Spirit of the Lord, living by the Word, breathing out the Word, finding and proving the Word of God, and seeing that it's a miracle, provision of God on every level. It's a supernatural working of the Holy Ghost manifested through our life in every dimension of our life. Because that's what God showed. That's His church. That's what He promised. That's what He gave. I'm not interested in religion. I'm not interested in an event. And say, oh, we had an event. Oh, it was amazing. We had an event. How long ago? I'm interested in those things which Father has given through His wonderful relationship and communion. That is where Father has taken up dwelling and habitation. The anointing that He has given to us is doing one thing. The anointing that He's given to us teaches us something that we don't need anybody to teach us. Every single person of God, here's what I know. Every person from the Roman Catholic Church to the Presbyterian to the Pentecostal, anyone who's been born of the Spirit, the Holy Ghost is teaching them one thing. You're supposed to get over there and dwell in Jesus Christ. You're supposed to dwell in Him. You're supposed to live by Him, live in Him, and have no identity outside of Him. You're supposed to step into a realm of faith that you've been made one with Him, that He's in you and you're in Him. This is the definition of that which the anointing does. Come on. I'm glad you came. Hallelujah. Because what I am saying is absolutely the Word of God. And I'm so blessed when people get happy with the Word of God, because I'm going to tell you what, that's the first step of receiving what God has to give. That somebody who knows the joyful sound, somebody who begins to rejoice at the Word of the Lord, for His entrance of His Word brings light, brings revelation. Revelation results in the faith of God having free course and activity in your life. There are people who say, man, when I get finished listening to you preach, if I was going to take you for real, I'd have to change everything about my life. Right. Yes, exactly. Everything. Oh, but I've gotten so comfortable, and I love Jesus so much, and I know He loves me, and I'm so comfortable doing all these things that is disobedience. I'm so comfortable living out my own life, I'm sure He doesn't mind.
Are you really that comfortable living out your own life at the expense of all this glory described by Jesus? All this glory seen in the new covenant? All that which was shown by Moses, by Elijah, by Enoch? I'm telling you right now, Enoch had visiting rights that I've never entered into, and I'm not happy with it. I'm needy. It's not fair. When Joshua and Daniel were little, if I gave Joshua something and Daniel didn't get it, Daniel's like, on me, dogging me. What about me? What about me? What about me? What about me? And I had to do something until, if I did it, he wasn't going to be silent on what about me. I'm saying, Father Enoch, what about me? What about me? What about me?
That's right.
Amen. It's time somebody gets stirred up with the will of the Father and the purposes that he has given and believes him. Believes him. Yes. Hallelujah. And I'll tell you right now to be accredited to you for righteousness. Father, say, I finally found somebody who believed me. See, Adam wouldn't trust God. He had the same problem that you and I have. He wouldn't trust God. Praise God, Abraham would. Praise God, one man stood up out of the billions and would trust God. You listen to me and you be warned. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the last days, the day of the coming of the Son of Man. There was only 8 souls saved. Everybody else thought they were right too. 8 souls. Think about it. Methuselah was still alive. There was a lot of men who were part of those who knew all the things about God and that he had done. This, you can still go visit the cherubim that guarded the way to the tree of life. There's no evidence that it was removed until that day. I guarantee you, when the time the clock has rolled back and you're able to fully understand those things that are not unveiled at this moment in time, we'll see that the majority of men are just like nothing changes about man. If there's anything that is so obvious about men, is they're constantly repeating their history. We see that on a macro scale. We see that on a macro scale. We see that in a span of a decade. We see it in a span of 100 years. Clearly in 1,000 years. Over and again, man just constantly reproducing, repeating his history. Because man has within him the exact same thing. Same innate issues. And God, the Holy Ghost, has come break us out of that. God, the Holy Ghost came, made a new man. God, the Holy Ghost came and made a new creation. God came and made a heavenly man, and we're willing to go back and plow with Adam. God came and made a heavenly man, and we're willing to go and habitate with those who fail. Come on. It's time you get a separation between light and darkness, good and evil, God and Satan. A heavenly vision Paul was received from heaven was the ability to turn people from Satan to God. It's first and foremost, people are going to have to understand a dividing line for their own self. Have they fully understood what it means to be turned from Satan unto God? What it means to fully come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord, and I shall receive you. Touch not the unclean thing, and I shall be your Father, and you shall be my people. I shall be your God, you shall be my people. I shall be your Father, and you shall be my sons and my daughters. Hallelujah. We're going to build that little spirit up, baby. It's going to get strong. I know you're reaching for your bottle. See, her spirit really isn't any, it's just as big as anybody else's spirit. It's confined to a smaller body. Many people's spirits never move really or develop past that. They never, they lay dormant. They lay dormant and dead before they introduce to Jesus. And we're introduced to Jesus and our spirit becomes alive to God. Hallelujah. Yeah. Totally broken from the bonds of that which caused us to be foreign and alien from him. And yet, as newborn babes, many people do not desire the sincere nourishment of God's word. Something, oh, well, I read my Bible once. My goodness, people, that's like telling me you ate once. You ate once. Guess what? You dead now. You dead. You dead? I eat once a week. You about to die. You've been in a concentration camp. You're withering away. No wonder you have no spiritual ability to open your mouth and say, oh, Lord Jesus, I love you so much. The life of God's not been developed. It doesn't come like a gushing forth of rivers. Ann and I stood in front of Victoria Falls the other day. And I was tired. And I didn't really want to do anything. I was preaching 3 meetings a day. And Phil said, no. He says, let's go to a really cool spot. I said, no, man, it's okay. He said, no, you're going. And you'll thank me later. He said, because you had to put on the rain suit and everything because the falls get you soaking wet. And, you know, I wasn't feeling like getting wet. And I'm like so tired. And I'm like, in the name of Jesus, I'm not going to be sick kind of thing. So you see, he was so insistent. I went, I stood there in front of Niagara Falls, forgive me, Victoria Falls, getting soaked, getting drenched. I can't move. I turned to Ann, I said, that's what the power of God looks like flowing out of me. Hallelujah. That's the first step where you begin to believe what God has spoken, what God has said, what he declared. There's a lot of it. Oh, I wish I could have that. You're pathetic. You wish you could have that. What? You wish you could have that so because you have in your mind that somehow you've got to earn it, you've got to develop it, you've got to make it happen. Some special event's got to happen. There's sinners all around your little world. God's bigger than that. He said it, and it's so. God proclaimed it, and it came to pass. It's now. It's happened. It's ours. It's time. People start taking the good word of God up into their lips and saying, Father, what you proclaimed is true. Yeah. I'm telling you right now, that's true humility. I'm telling you, the opposite of it is true pride. God said, I'll fight against pride. I've come to make war against pride. I tell you now, listen, I know what this holy indignation does. I know the fire that is in my belly. I know the Spirit of the Lord that speaks through me. I know how Father feels about these things. You may look upon just a mortal body and a mortal frame and say whatever excuses you want to say and make up whatever stories you want to make up to disqualify those things which I declare. But I'm telling you, this is a passion to the living God. These are the passions of the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. It's not us that speaks, but the Spirit of our Father which is in us. Amen. Hallelujah. I, for one, have rivers of living water. I've been given it. It's mine. I've been made a new creation. I'm a new creature. My name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. My sins have been totally washed away. I'm telling you, the Spirit of the living God has come to dwell on the inside of me. He lives here. He abides here. He speaks here. I'll have it no other way. I'm saying to you, you should have it no other way as well. Because when you begin to live out these things, because they are yours, it's given to you, it's something that you've embraced, you've been willing to believe God. You've been willing to make God the faithful God that he is, the covenant-keeping God that he is. You won't believe anything else. When that begins to happen, I'm telling you right now, the reality of what he proclaimed begins to be made manifest in a way that goes beyond anything that you've understood up to this point. It's going to come out of your mouth. I'm going to tell you right now, your words are going to be made into salvation. Hallelujah. The confession of your mouth is going to be made. I'm telling you right now, you begin to take up these words. You know, when God told Abraham actually that he was giving him the land for an inheritance, that's how most translators translate that particular Hebrew word. The word literally more perfectly means possess it. He said, I will give you the land for your possession. And then, so that you may possess it. And Abraham says in response to God in Genesis chapter 15, he said, how shall I know that I will be able to possess it? Dear people, this is something that is more than you just basically couching your way to heaven. This is something that you lay hold on.
You lay hold on eternal life. Yeah. Somebody gave you this opportunity and you jumped on it with all fours and with your teeth, and you're like, I'm not letting go. This is mine.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said they're going to give you $3 trillion. You said deposit it in the bank now. Get it in my account now. Now, while I got you on the phone. Wire it over now. Now. Not later. Now. Or whatever else it is that you think would make life so different for you. And of course, that would make life different for you in a wrong way. But that's where men's value is. Men's value is in that. Big S with a railroad track running down the middle of it. S for satanic. Railroad track for train to hell. By and large, amen. Somebody talking, people are so fixated in the church are talking about money. Get $23.33 and God's going to give you $23 million. Do it now because there's only 10 people that can get in on this. I mean, I'm telling you right now, when I was a little guy, I wanted to crawl through the television and choke that person, you know, that was about to kill the innocent person or shoot him. One day I had my BB gun and I actually pointed at the television and I took the guy out. It just didn't go all the way through. And I was in trouble because I busted the TV. But never have I been wanting to shut people down. Like some of the people that I hear talking in the name of Jesus. But you know what? That's Father's business. And I tell you right, I'm going to talk louder than they talk.
Yeah.
And I'm going to believe God. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to beg God. I'm going to plead with God. He's going to see me so needy until he uses me ultimately. I'm going to be used of God more than they've been used.
Amen.
You watch. Amen. I'll tell you right now. the race isn't the fastest person. It's the person who doesn't stop running. Hallelujah. And especially when it's a long distance race that has no mileage set on it. Because people are going to start falling off after about 50, 60 miles. 100 miles, somebody's just me and a few other people are running. And I'm telling you, I'm not stopping because I will run and not be weary. I shall walk and not be faint. I've understood something in God. If you do not weary, you shall reap. Hallelujah. Yes. If you do not weary in well-doing, you shall reap if you faint not.
Amen.
And I learned how not to weary, nor how to faint. For they that wait upon the Lord shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. That's how I don't weary. That's how I don't faint. I know Father has got an expectation. He's got a purpose in my life. It's not going to be status quo Christianity. It's not going to go with the same old message, same old model, same old example. You know, same thing that you can demonstrate. The Father's waiting for those who are willing to radically stand up in the glory of heaven and the new creation in the new man. Those who are transformed by the power of God, full of the Holy Ghost, and have come and stepped into the maturity and ministry of Jesus Christ. Paul stepped into the fullness of the ministry of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. He said so. Why? Because the gift was a treasure to him.
Yes.
The gift wasn't just another part of my life. Well, you know, I have a bunch of dimensions in my life. I have this part, my job, and then I have my family, and then we have the church, and then we go on vacation, and then we got several things that we like to do for hobbies. Why? You don't want heaven. You're fine on this earth. Because the only thing that's going to be in heaven is Jesus. All the rest of that stuff is going to be messed up. It's going to be gone. It's going to be messed up. And now you're going to be really bored because you don't have your hobbies and your job and your family and your this and your that. Man, but I'm telling you right now, from the perspective of a human thinking and human earthly perspective, that sounds like, oh, man, I'm going to lose everything. No. Because you step into Christ Jesus like this radically with total abandonment, and suddenly you step into a whole nother realm of having everything.
Yeah.
Having everything. Everything. Everything that pertains to life and godliness. Every spiritual blessing. Every glory that belongs to that which God produced. He's the author of life.
Yeah.
Woo! You've not lived till you lived a day in heaven.
You've not lived the 24 hours until you've lived raptured in the glory. Shaken under the presence and the power of God, because your body's getting used to standing under that realm and dimension of His power. Somebody said, well, I got baptized in the Holy Ghost once and I lost English language. How long ago was that event? You're proud of an event. You should be ashamed. You should be ashamed. The event took place so that you could live that kind of life.
That's right.
So that you could live that kind of life. You should be ashamed that God had brought not only such a glorious revelation of His life and made it manifest through the Word Christ Jesus and declared it through His Word and pulled on you and I by the Holy Ghost, but also gave you that event in your life, and somehow you're going to treat it as an event and not recognize that you just stepped into a realm called the glory of heaven, the glory of the Son, the place where Christ Jesus now dwells, a heavenly realm, and that's just going to be an event. My goodness, dear people, grab a hold of these things tonight and don't let them go. Begin to let the divine utterance come up out of your belly continually. I mean, I know what God's people will do. They'll all start sounding like me. Just grow up a little bit in the Spirit. You'll have a Holy Ghost roar going down. I know the pride of life don't like to be less than somebody else. I know about that evil thing. But that's why I'm just slapping it around tonight, and I'm getting ready to smash it. I got my boots on. I'm getting ready to step on the thing and deal with it for a final death blow. It cannot have its right to slime around God's people. Hallelujah. Messing up the holy assembly. Hallelujah. Peter made it really simple. He said, then Peter said unto them, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. How much easier can it be? How much easier can it be? It's just that people don't even understand what the gift of the Holy Ghost is. They don't value that the person, the Holy Ghost, has come to live and dwell on the inside of us. He brings all the glory of heaven. He brings all the glory of the Father. He brings all the glory of the Son. He brings all of that ability to live a life that cannot be diminished. It cannot end. It's forever eternal in the heavens. It brings all authority, all power, all blessings, all divine riches, everything that could possibly be ever desired by man. And we're busy earning 2 copper coins. We're busy building our sand castles in the sand. They're going to be washed away with the incoming tide. What vanity, what vexation of spirit. Listen to the richest man that ever lived. Listen to the man who possessed all things, Solomon. Listen to the preacher preaching Ecclesiastes. Listen to him summate all that you might ever have in this life. And bring it down to nothing but vanity and vexation of spirit. And declare to us, here's the conclusion and the sum of the whole matter. All that matters is to fear the Lord and to keep His commandments. To keep that which He said. To keep it saying, I hope that you have not forgotten what the Holy Ghost ministered in here on Sunday night. Because I'm telling you right now, to me, it was eye-opening, spirit-opening revelation. As Father began to make known to me some of the things that we declared here in this place, I'm changed forever. I'm a different person. At the entrance of His Word, He gives revelation, He gives light, He gives understanding. And after having received revelation and light and understanding, having seen Him just that much more, you can never be the same. You can never go back to being the same person. Man, some of you, if you wanted me to mellow out and quiet down, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm getting fired up right now. Yeah. I tell you, I feel like finally I'm giving myself completely over to the Holy Ghost. Let Him have His will and way in my life. Yeah. Hallelujah. When we were still in decision making, God used us to shake nations. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, we're about ready to take over the world. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah.
I'm telling you, I'm pressing in by the Spirit of the living God to go into nations that nobody can get in right now. Why? Because God's going to show a display of how supernatural it is and how supernatural, how He has all power. Anybody who would believe, listen, anybody who would believe Him, He will show Himself great on their behalf. He will do exploits to them just by the very act that they're willing to believe Him and go do things that nobody else will do. That's what makes the difference. This is the gift of the Holy Ghost made available. What is Peter talking about? He's talking about in the context of that just what they had just received. He says it again over here real quickly. Look with me in Acts chapter 10 and verse 48. Those of you watching by web or by YouTube, I pray in the name of Jesus you can never tolerate religion another day.
Come on.
Your flavor of it, anyone else's flavor of it, go ahead, step into this heavenly realm, get baptized in the Holy Ghost, and understand what it means to be saved, transformed by the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, made a new creation. Old things, all of them, gone, bye-bye, don't exist no more. All this here is Jesus now, from here on in. Hallelujah. Praise God. I won't allow anything but Jesus to live. Something else, come try to tell me it lives. I'm going to tell you right now. Every bit of energy, every bit of strength, every bit of zeal in my body comes to bear. I got more than I'm displaying right now. Believe me. Hallelujah. Sukurimandadea. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, when I was younger, I could put some serious wrestle on anybody. Listen, but now I don't wrestle after the manner of flesh and blood. I have been given a whole new dimension of authority and strength and spiritual ability. I've been given a whole other dimension of divine energy. Yes. I'm telling you, this glorious realm of divine power on the inside of me comes to bear, and no spiritual wickedness has a chance to remain. And I'm telling you, the same is about you. But you can't sit there all passive. Oh, I just want to know Jesus. Oh, I just don't know why I go through the things I go. Oh, I want you guys to pray for me. I want you to just pray with me, pray for me. I just don't know. I'm just going to try to carry on.
You're getting nothing. Getting nothing. And no faith in that. I'm just going to try to carry on. In this world of sin and woe. Now you're going through all that you're going through because you allow the devil run right over top of you.
Right.
Satan is rebellious. He'll go past every no trespassing sign that exists and tear it down while he's going by.
Yeah.
You're going to have to stand up and do some smacking. You're going to have to stand up and do some serious authority stuff. Authority. As many as believe, He gave them the authority. Jesus said, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. I'm looking for somebody to agree with me. Because that's the way He's personally said it to me. And certainly you may derive that from Matthew 28, verse 18. Look at this verse in Acts 10:48. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm believing God, I'm going to get fired up. I'm telling you right now, I'm believing God that Holy Ghost passion is going to grab hold of me. I'm telling you right now, listen, faces like lions.
Yeah.
Somebody said, he looks mad. The lion's not mad. That's just the way he looks. This is the way he looks. He's happy. He looks like that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, oh, must you run? Oh, must you run? Oh, can't you just linger? Oh, can't you slow down so us little ones can keep up with you? God said you're going to run like horses, believe in the same supernatural God that I believe in, and you'll have the same supernatural strength to do what God has purposed us to do. I'm not slowing down for no man.
Amen.
I'm not abdicating from what God said and becoming that person who values what men need more than what God has desired, what God has commanded. We must demand of ourselves, of ourselves. God's called you and I to come into a place and to present our bodies a on fire, burning, living sacrifice. I didn't say sitting in the shade, living sacrifice. I didn't say being dawdled and pampered with all kinds of things that suit your fancy sacrifice. Give me a break. Come on. On fire, burning, living sacrifice.
Yes, Father.
See, one that's holy and acceptable.
Yes.
Don't be conformed to this world, but be transfigured.
Yes.
By thinking different.
Right.
I want you to get into a place tonight where you think different, you act different, you recognize, wait a minute, God's not going to come down and start moving my voice around, moving my lips up and down, and speaking through my mouth without my will and consent. God has waited for me to say, I'm lifting up my voice. I'm going to begin to shout to the Lord. I'm going to begin to cry out unto the living God. I'm going to give him no rest. 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 We don't go and preach Matthew chapter 12. This is why men, or chapter 18, this is why men ought to always pray and not to faint, just so that we can have a sermon to preach. It's to declare the word of God to begin to move you into the actions of the Spirit of the Lord so you can participate with what God demands. He demands it. To come with boldness and persistence and keep on knocking and keep on shouting and saying, I will not bend, I will not bow, I will not move, I will not let go of you. I will not let go of you, Father. I will not let go of you. Holy Spirit. I will not let go of you, Jesus. I will not let go. I must have your blessing. I must have that which only you can give, God.
Yes.
This begins. This is the beginning. This ain't in the middle. This is the beginning. These are the essential dimensions of the display of life, the spirit of life on the inside of you and me. It begins to put out every fire and every interest of earthly things. La masekene hiperesia. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Somebody's going to get more interested in God than they are in themselves. People are going to start worshiping God for who he is instead of who they are. I watch it all the time. I watch sacrilege and idolatry go down as people worship God for who they are. If they feel good about themselves, they worship God. If they don't feel good about themselves, they don't worship God. If they feel good about their circumstances, they worship God. If they don't feel good about their circumstances, they don't worship God. If they feel good in their emotions and in their attitudes, they worship God. If they don't feel good in their emotions and their attitudes, they don't worship God. Thus they worship God for who they are rather than who he is. I'm telling you, this idolatry's coming down. I'm telling you, God's going to raise up radical people. You watch. I know what he's going to do. I know what Father's going to do. Father's going to raise up radical people in this earth. And I, for one, am not going to be left out. I'm not going to stand and watch God raise up radical people while I sit on the sideline. I'm playing. Your coach, you're putting me in. You need me. You're putting me in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There ain't no coach going to see somebody stand on the sideline screaming, saying, let's get this thing done. You're putting me in. Hey, come on, get moving. And him not go in. Just put your helmet on. You're going in. Passion is everything on every level in every dimension of life.
Yeah.
If you can't get stirred up, if you can't get passionate, where everything in your being is focused on getting the thing done, you're left out.
Yeah.
You're on the sidelines.
Yeah.
He loves you. How many people, I don't really want to do anything for you, Father. I just want to make heaven. Well, you can feel that way, that pathetic way, if you want. But you don't belong around here. You don't. There's a Baptist church down the street. And I pray the Baptist church are going to get on fire. There's other churches. Listen, God's raising up an army, yeah. Not a social club. Oh, yeah. You say, I'm raising up a social club.
No.
Father's raising up an army.
Yeah.
Father's raising up highly disciplined soldiers.
Yes.
Father's raising up fully matured sons. Sons. Sons that have been liberated simply by believing what God has said to step into the full dimensions of the inheritance. This is what Paul's preaching in Galatians chapter 4.
Yeah.
He's saying, a child differs nothing from a servant, yeah. Though he be lord of everything, though he be inheritor of everything, though it all is passing to him, though it all belongs to him.
Right. Mm.
But is under governors and tutors until the time he steps into his sonship.
Yeah.
And he declares to us, you are now sons. It's an event that happened. It's the day of the new birth, the day that you were empowered from on high, being baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Now you are an heirs of God. That's not something just in the future. That's now. It's now needing to be lived out. It's now needing to be shown who has all authority in heaven and earth. Jesus is not going to come down and say, I have all authority in heaven and earth. He's left it to me and to you. I'm just taking up my job. Come on. There's a lot of things we can do. I love to surf. I've been surfing one time in 2 years. I'm busy in the kingdom. It's not about my life. I mean, bless your little heart. You got time to go run around and play all day. Bless your little pea-picking heart. But I pray in the name of Jesus, the fire got to get a hold of you. And you'll decide, you'll define yourself as more than you're doing whatever it is you purpose to do. Yes. And you let the fire of God begin to burn in you. Yes. And you'll find yourself living out what this Bible says.
Yes.
You'll find yourself living out what this Bible says. Yes. You won't be reading the Bible saying, oh no, oh I got to do this, and oh I got to do that, and oh I got to do this other thing. No, you get filled with the Spirit of the living God, and you begin allowing God to have free course in your life, and then you discover, wow, I'm doing this and doing this. This is just all happening in my life naturally. It's just that which I want to do. It's that which I'm propelled to do, compelled to do. I pray in Jesus' name you get yourself into some prayer meetings. Cause your veins to pop out your neck. Turn your face red.
Yeah.
Give you a sore throat.
Yeah.
Actually, I've never really gotten a sore throat praying. God gives a supernatural throat coat. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've never gotten a sore throat. I got a sore throat preaching in Papua New Guinea. That night air there in the South Pacific. And so much of that was just the forces of hell coming out against me, things that I had never encountered before. But I'm telling you right now, it only lasted 2 nights.
Yeah.
And the revival meeting was 5 nights. I had 3 nights with a very strong voice. And even on those 2 nights when it was weak, the altar calls were filled with people. People were saved, healed, touched by the power of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know what? It's coming to America. It's going to happen in America. You know, I was telling someone, I was telling someone just recently, what happened in Zambia when we were just in Zambia, and they said, "Yeah, that's coming to America." I said, "Guess what? All the people in Zambia were Americans in the meeting." I mean, there was about 4 Zambian, maybe a little more Zambian, missionaries there. Hallelujah. But I see a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost that I want you to tap into. And you're going to have to, there's 2 things you're going to have to be confident about: those things which God has said, possessing them as your own. Not waiting for someday, because that's doubt and unbelief. And God ain't ever going to move with doubt and unbelief. He's going to move with faith. And faith comes because you believe what God said in His Word. That's how it comes. That's easy. Just real simple. Trust in God. Father said it. Vayomer Elohim. God said it. Vayichen. And it was so. Hallelujah. Every creative event in Genesis 1 and 2 gives to us an understanding, a little bit more of an understanding about the creative event that He made when He brought us forth as new creation in Christ Jesus. Born of the Spirit of the living God. God, the power of God overshadowed us. Hallelujah. And that holy thing that was conceived on the inside of us, that was born on the inside of us, was by the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Boko Ramaseya. Boko Ramaseya. Boko Ramaseya. No, people say, well, I just, Religion says, I just want a little salvation. I'm still just a sinner. No, no. That's a lie from hell. You a holy one. You a saint. You've been given righteousness and holiness. Brought forth in his image and his likeness. Filled up with all that he himself possesses. Filled with his glory.
Yes.
You're going to have to believe that. Then you begin. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then you get passionate about it. So passionate about it, you start laying hands on the... Hey, thank you, Lord Jesus, for touching baby. I haven't even gotten halfway. Do you need to help me a little bit? Huh? Lord Jesus, I thank you for touching my baby right now. She's been not feeling good. She's not used to sitting in church this long. And we had a wonderful time when we were singing, but we all got worn out. And then Papa's up there shouting and hollering. I don't have a clue about what he's screaming about, but it does feel good. Hallelujah. I used to take Joshua when he was this side and size, and I just lay him over my shoulder. Of course, she's a tank. I'm not sure he was quite this chubby. And I would just lay him over my shoulder even when he was younger than this, and I'd begin to pray. And you know, I start off praying, maybe I start off praying soft, but it don't take long. Man, I'm telling you right now, I'm pulling the house down because the shout comes out. It ain't that, you know, I feel like I got to yell. God, the Holy Ghost obviously feels like he wants to yell. It's just passion that can be not restrained. Yeah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, I've never had that because you never gave yourself to that. Huh. Yeah. There's a lot of things you don't have because you never gave yourself to it. You never did it. Huh? You know what? There's a lot of people who never went swimming. They don't know how to swim because they never went swimming. They never learned how to swim. You go out and get in the water and you'll learn how to swim too.
Yes, sir.
You get over here in this realm of divine glory and give yourself to it and you'll understand what I'm talking about as well. You'll shout out too. Hallelujah. The gift of God. The gift of the Holy Ghost. I never read verse 48, so hold that up for me and let me read that. Hallelujah. You know, and of course, what's happening here is Peter's talking about the house of Cornelius and what took place in Cornelius' house. That as they begin to just preach, I mean, goodness gracious, when the heart is ready, look at what happens. Look at how easy it is to have these things. There's no tarrying here. There was no reason that the church should have spent so many years thinking that they had to tarry and wait. All they needed to do was read Acts chapter 10, and they could have found out that a short sermon would result in the same Pentecostal glory. Amen. And he says, and it says right here in, let me see, Acts chapter 10, where are we at? Huh? Acts chapter 11. Wait a minute. Verse 48, 47. It says, can any man forbid water to these, that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? Now, this isn't the verse of Scripture I'm wanting to, the gift of the Holy Ghost. Forgive me. Verse 45. And they of the circumcision, look at this. And they of the circumcision, the Gentiles, forgive me. And they of the circumcision, the Jews, which believed, were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. See, Peter said in verse 38 of chapter 2, verse 39, forgive me, and you shall receive, forgive me, verse 38, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Here, once again, he's talking about the gift of the Holy Ghost. It's the promise of the Father's best gift to us. Yes. And what happens? Now, all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost expressions of divine utterances begin to flow through us that begins on a level that surpasses everything that we understand about language. It surpasses everything that we understand about prophetic utterances and takes us into every unlimited dimension of those prophetic utterances. It's this declaration, this gift, this declaration of God's greatest riches now having been poured out upon us and given to each and every single person. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord. Verse 39 in chapter 2 says, this is to you and to your children and to your children's children and to as many as the Lord should call and as many as are far off. Everybody, anyone who will receive. Jesus opens up. Anyone who will believe. These works shall you do and greater works than these. These signs shall follow them to believe. These things are open to every single person without limitation, without regard to who you are, your background, your ethnicity. Just look with me quickly in 2 Corinthians. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Hallelujah.
Get ready, sweetheart. You're getting ready to get into some Holy Ghost meetings. Get ready. You're getting ready to build up a great endurance for sitting at long stretches in the presence of the Lord. Somebody said, you know, what do you really model your ministry after? I mean, these services go so long, you know, and I just like to refer people to how Paul ministered, how that he was ministering so late that there was a person sitting in the window on the second story, fell down asleep in the meeting. And that's why I don't feel quite as bad when people fall asleep, knowing that people fell asleep at Paul's meetings as well. And the person died. They fell down and killed themselves in the meeting. Scripture says Paul went down and they raised them up and ministered unto them. And then they continued on ministering until day. Ah, hallelujah. And then they got up and went to the next place. Hallelujah. I'm in expectation. I'm in expectation for there being no differentiation between that which we are living in right now and that which Father exists in. Yeah. Such a heavenly realm. This is what people in the past laid hold on, whether it was Father Nash and Charles Finney, or whether it was Evan Roberts, or whether it was, you know, Wigglesworth or other people who so stepped over into the realm of the heavenly that they didn't even really have to open up their mouth. Hallelujah. You know, and the people would come under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I'm always so blessed at, you know, the boldness of the faith that Wigglesworth had. It wasn't until he was in his 50s that he finally stepped into the baptism of the Holy Ghost. But when he stepped into the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he got what he was always looking for in God. And so it was very special to him. It was very precious to him. So he gave his entire life over to it. He quit doing his plumbing business and quit being bivocational and gave himself over to a prayer meeting, an encounter with a place of interacting with the living God. Come on now. Yeah. Father is called. Listen, I'm just laying the foundation because I want to get into Romans chapter 8 tonight. Because God describes to us how to walk into an intimacy of living in Him and walking in Him and finding our whole manner of living and thinking and existence as a function of that which the Holy Ghost is ministering to us. And I, for one, am very hungry for this. So, you know, it doesn't bother me at all to say I've just laid the foundation to get into Romans chapter 8. Some of you are bowing your heads and thinking about what you got to do tomorrow. And you need to forget about what you got to do tomorrow. Amen. You're thinking about, well, I've got to have sleep or I've got a headache all day. You don't have to have that headache. Hallelujah. You don't have to be all tired and worn out. All you got to do is get up in the morning after a long night of being at church and start praying in the Holy Ghost till the refreshing comes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Instead of stumbling into the kitchen and trying to boil up a pot of coffee and talk about how late the preacher kept you to the meeting. Hallelujah. Kuda Masa De Renea. Hey, come on, people. Come on, man. We're looking for a day that is soon to come, an event that God is preparing right now, where the masses who've never been touched by heaven begin to press into the kingdom. Why? Because you quit diddle-dallying around, playing patty cake religion, and lay hold on the eternal God. This is true. Huh? You quit being satisfied with whatever little blip on the spiritual monitor you might have that measures us slightly above negative one. Hallelujah. You start going for full registration of the only begotten Son. Hallelujah. Pakadera Nai. At least we're getting a response out of someone. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to look at something that you have. Look at what I told you. I was going to redefine things for you tonight.
Yeah.
You thought I was kidding. Thought I was just. Look at here. I was just speaking by the Spirit of the Lord. I'm just speaking by the Spirit of the Lord. I'm just reading your mail. I'm reading God's mail to you. I'm reading what Father has declared and what He said. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The other night was in here and I started talking about you can diagram the triune men and talk about the priest underwear. Geneva called me up the next morning and said, who told you? Did you get a video of the women's meeting? I said, no, I'm just speaking by the Spirit. Yeah. She says, God, the Holy Ghost knows everything, doesn't he? Yeah, he knows everything. He will shock you. And he knows how you're responding to what I'm saying. And the base on your response is how much you're going to get. Because he's looking for the hungry and the thirsty. He's looking for the needy and the desperate. He's looking for those who aren't willing to be self-justified. And say, Pastor, you need to come and sit down and talk with me. Because I don't think you're sensitive to my special needs.
What?
We want to get you healed of your special needs.
Amen.
We want to get you healed of your special needs. Your special circumstances. Why? I mean, think about it. What? John and Charles Wesley's mom, like she had 18 kids, right? Was it 18 or 19? Huh? 19 kids.
You got special needs. I got a child.
You got a child. One. I mean, why don't you follow the faith of Miss Wesley with 19 kids? And look at that woman raised up mighty men and women for the kingdom of God. Because she knew how to take hold of heaven. Give me a break. My special needs, my special circumstances. I'm unique from all other people. No, this is a general epistle to all who will hear. This is a general epistle to any man, any woman, any boy, any girl, anybody, whosoever has ears to hear. And the thing about it is, you looky here. Look, the way, listen. You walked in here of your own accord. When you walked in here, you said voluntarily, tell me like it is. I come here to hear Pastor Mark declare by the Spirit what I have need of. Don't act like I'm intruding. I'm not coming to your house. I didn't come to your place. You came to my place. You came into my house. You said, I come to hear what Pastor Mark has to say by the Spirit of the Lord. So everybody ought to be real happy about this. Don't feel shocked. Oh, no. What is he saying now? He's not supposed to be talking that way. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Masa terinea. Ekirinamanje salopahora. I'm about ready to run. I tell you, if there was some chandeliers, I'd be tempted to swing. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ko mangare sanaya. Ko tabasa teranaya. Ho se pakala na shea. Woo! 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 Thank you, Father, for the anointing. Mighty God. Hallelujah. Listen. We are going to demonstrate to the Father that we're passionate about everything He wants to pour out upon us. Let people call it emotionalism. Let them call it all these other isms. We're just here wanting only those things which Father can pour out. And we're letting Him know He's got our full attention, our spirit, soul, and body. And there's absolutely nothing we want to do. Just sit down for just one more second, just one more minute, five more minutes, something like that. I believe a big part of this, Geneva, the dynamics of a big part of this is where people are going to move beyond the constraints of men. So much of what people will and will not do is their self-consciousness about men's opinion. They're restrained by what men think and by fear. When we step out of that, and all of a sudden we're set apart by God, shut in with Him in a public place. And we're saying to Father, I don't care if everybody thinks I'm absolutely out of my mind. I just got to have you. I just got to have all that you've got to give.
I want nothing less but than everything. Because Father has promised us a realm of all of His fullness. And He has bathed us in it, in His Word. Dear people, when we grab a hold of the reality of what we read right here in verse, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7. It says, but we have this treasure. What is this treasure? The gift of the Holy Ghost. We have this treasure. When Paul said in Ephesians 1:13, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, he was talking about the baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire. He wasn't talking about salvation experience. He was talking about the Holy Spirit of promise, the promise of the Father, which said he, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Hallelujah. Oh, Prama. If you don't know the reference, it's Luke 24, 48 through 49. Hallelujah. Get the Word of God burning in your heart, your mouth, and your mind. Just decide all that you want to be is that which God described, and you will be nothing less. You think about these things all day. You rehearse them. You meditate on them. You recite them that you may be strong and very courageous to possess it. To possess it. To possess it. You recite these things, you rehearse them, you meditate on them day and night, that you may possess it, that you may be strong and very courageous, that you may possess it, that it be yours. Not later, now. Not tomorrow, now. Not when the clock strikes 12, now. Hallelujah. Not at New Year's, now. Not in the sweet by and by, now. Today. At this moment. We have this treasure. We have a treasure in these earthen vessels that the excellency of the power, because anybody with this treasure is displaying a whole bunch of power. But we want to focus and point out where the power comes from and who the power belongs to. Oh, for anybody who possesses this realm of glory, they have this power. For God, by His divine power, has given to us everything that pertains unto life and godliness, because He's called us to glory and to this virtue. Look here. He says that the excellency of the power may be of God. May be seen to be of God. May be observed that it is God that is doing this. You know what happened with Daniel? You know what happened with Joseph? You know what happened with the men of old? People around them said, they have within them the excellency of the power of God. They have within them the Spirit of the Most High God. It's time that such report. It's time that such reputation belong again to the people of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a price to pay. There's a price to pay. People will go to school and study 8-10 hours a day, give themselves to learning. But when it comes to seeking God and being on their face before the living God with their Bible open, crying out to the Lord, it's rare that a person gives an hour a day to that. No wonder. It is a measure of the need. It is a measure of the neediness that exists within the church and within our lives. It's going to change.
Yes, it is.
It's going to change in Jesus' name. And I'm going to tell you right now, once you find this realm of glory that I'm talking about, it won't be boring.
No.
It won't be laborious. It'll be heaven.
Yeah.
You'd be caught away. You might have to labor a bit to enter in.
Yes.
You might have to give yourself to tearing down the strongholds of wanting to sit around and be entertained and be lazy. There's too many of God's people who've never knew how to just stay committed to something until a job was done. They always bouncing around. One week they're selling stuff for Sears and Roebuck. The next week they're selling stuff for Acorns and Squirrel Management. The next week they're selling stuff. I mean, it just goes on and on. This week they want to be this, and the next week they want to be that, and next month they're going to be something else. It's just a physical manifestation of a spiritual lack. It's time you and I give ourselves over to the things of the kingdom of God. God raises up in that realm the most highly disciplined folks on the planet. Hallelujah. The most highly put together, you know, the most
excellent of nature and character people that exist. It's time we let the Holy Ghost take over.
Amen.
It's time you learn how to let your emotions and your passions come into complete submission to the Holy Ghost. That's why he gave to us this realm of divine utterance. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Paul said, have you begun in the Spirit to now be made perfect by the flesh? No, you began in the Spirit to be made perfect by the Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. In other words, you began in the Holy Ghost to be made perfect by the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
The one who began this good work in you shall finish it. All you've got to do is be willing to participate and give yourself to this thing that God is doing. I want to close here tonight, even though I really thought when I came to the meeting tonight that I was going to walk you through the relationship that is revealed in Romans chapter 8, because I don't really feel that people have laid hold or been willing to handle the beauty of the relationship with the Holy Ghost that is described in Romans chapter 8. It's one of the chapters of the Bible where God the Holy Ghost is mentioned more than any other chapter in the Bible. And it is a powerful declaration of this glorious relationship and success of walking in the realms of those who are heirs of God and co-inheritors with Jesus. I mean, I'm not going to get to that tonight. I'm going to have to get to that another night. But I'm telling you, it's on me. I'm telling you, I'm just about decided I'm not telling or preaching anything other than about the Holy Ghost from here on in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus said, I'm going to go away. Jesus said, I'm going to go away, but I'm going to send you another one just like me. Hallelujah. He's going to mentor you, teach you. He's going to walk with you. You're going to live with him, sleep with him at night, eat with him for breakfast, lunch, and supper as the disciples did with Jesus. He's going to show you how signs and wonders and miracles function. He's going to show you how to step over into the dimensions of heaven, see Father before you and on your right hand that you should not be moved. Hallelujah. He's the treasure. He's the Father's promise. He's the promise of the Father that Isaiah prophesied about, that Jeremiah prophesied about in 31:33. I can go on Isaiah 43:3. I'm in so many verses of Scripture describing what God would do when he poured out his Spirit from on high.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Upon the dry and thirsty soul of those people who are desiring the things of heaven. No longer wanted to live different or separated or absent in any way from the living God, but wanted to be a part of his company all day long, every day.
Yes.
The Lord tells us in this verse of Scripture in Ephesians chapter 3, just turn there. Hallelujah. How many of you can come to a prayer meeting tomorrow night? Hallelujah. Just cry out. It's a prayer meeting to cry out for the moving of God in the city.
Yeah.
To cry out for the millions who've never seen Jesus. They've never seen the power of God displayed. They've never seen signs and wonders and miracles. They've never seen the display of his divine power and glory. Sikara masaterene. Belanda ki apronasai. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not good with that. I'm not good with that. I'm not good with it. The fact that there's millions of people in Southern California that have never seen the display of divine power and glory. I'm not good with that. I'm not going to sit here and just abdicate and act like it's somebody else's responsibility. Point my finger to what all the lack that goes on in other people's life when I'm the biggest slacker of all. Because the biggest slacker of all would be those who know and don't do nothing about it.
Right.
Come on, people. It'd be better not to know than to just be willing to just carry on as we are. Hallelujah. Here the Lord tells to us in verse 16 of chapter 3, and that's what's going on here in this place tonight. It tells to be strengthened by the Spirit in our inner man. Hallelujah. That we may be rooted and grounded, established in the faith. Hallelujah. Are you with me tonight?
Yeah. Yes.
That we may be able to comprehend. Established in the faith. What's faith? New man. New nature. One with God. In Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus in me. Temple of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Expressions of God's divine fullness coming out of me like Victoria Falls and Niagara converging on each other. And then it's still more. Hallelujah.
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 That we may be able to comprehend
Because we established. Because I'm rooted. I'm grounded. Nobody telling me I'm an old man. Nobody telling me that Satan still has some hold on me. Nobody telling me that I haven't received the gift of salvation. Nobody telling me I haven't received the gift of the Holy Ghost. Nobody telling me that I don't have all the fullness of God, that He's not in me and I'm not in Him. There's just no way. I'm established. I'm rooted. Now, there, in that place of the realms of faith, of that which God did for us by the Holy Ghost, through the outpouring of Christ Jesus' blood and resurrection, under the authority of His name, which is above every name.
Yes.
Now, because I am established there, nobody can move me. I'm rooted. I'm like a big oak tree. I got roots so far, so deep, you can't chop me down. You can't blow me out. God wants to establish us. He wants to establish us. Unshakable, unmovable. Hallelujah. No imagination, no wind of doctrine, no thought, no tricks of men able to in any way veer us off course with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Now in that place, in that identity, in knowing what Christ did for us when He died at Calvary, what He did when He raised up from the dead on the third day, what took place when He was crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords and poured out the promise of the Father. Knowing that, established in that. Now, there's no fear there. There's no intimidation there. There's no question marks there. There's no wondering there. There's no hoping there. You there. You in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's time to get in. Just get in. Step in. Get in. Step in. Get in. It's time to get in. It's time to be no longer of a double mind or a doubtful mind or wondering if it's so or wondering if it could be. It's time to accept what God has said and begin to trust God and begin to walk with Him. Hallelujah. Begin to be what He said you are. Now, having been so established, you may comprehend with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. Then, in this dimension, in this place of buying in and receiving and saying it so and being it and there being established so that you're not moved ever again from it, there you know the love of Christ. You'll experience and know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. And in that place, you will be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, you listen to this. Listen to this verse of Scripture. Because there's a treasure to bring it to pass. There's a treasure to make this happen. There's a gift of God that has been given to establish this. Now unto Him who's able to do these things.
Yes.
Now unto Him who's able to do superabundantly.
Yes.
Above all that we think or ask. And I'm telling you right now, that just described all that we can think or be above all that we can think or ask. It just described the whole dimension, the full, unlimited privilege and opportunity that has been given. Now unto Him. God, the Holy Spirit, hallelujah, who is able to do super abundantly above all that we can think or ask according to the treasure, according to the gift of the Holy Ghost, according to the river, according to the power, according to the promise of the Father, according to not just a nature change, but not just a new heart and a new spirit, but His Holy Ghost who comes to live, who comes to live. Yeah, the disciples were clean through the word which He spoken unto them. But I'm going to tell you one thing they didn't have. The Holy Ghost was not in them. Because Jesus said, He's with you, but He shall be in you. It wasn't until the day after that He was raised up from the dead and poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the gift of the Holy Ghost at that day was given unto man to overshadow men and to bring forth the new creation. According to the word and testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ and Nicodemus, a man must be born of the Spirit. Hallelujah. A man must be born of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost was not yet given. But after that, He was glorified. Tonight, I beg you, start seeing God the Holy Ghost on the inside of you. Start feeling Him on the inside of you. Let him begin to move in you. Let that river of heaven flow out of you, the divine utterances, just let them flow out of you. till all of a sudden joy begins to stir in you. You'll feel God the Holy Ghost when joy starts feeling stirring in you. You'll feel God the Holy Ghost when all of a sudden a fiery prayer starts stirring in you. You'll feel fire. You'll feel the fiery presence of the Holy Ghost when all of a sudden you've given your members over to that holy realm, to where that God may begin to surge through you and speak to you and direct you and lead you and translate you and use you. Just like he did Jesus. Just like he did Jesus. Everybody, would you stand with me?